नमस्कार, जय हिंद एंड हेलो। सो हियर वी आर इन द फोर्थ एपिसोड ऑफ पॉलिटिको मिलिट्री डिसीजंस इन जियोपॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया सिंस 1947। इन द लास्ट एपिसोड वी हैड डिस्कस्ड एनसर्कलमेंट ऑफ इंडिया बाय चाइना, वेयर एज पर मी द लैंड एनसर्कलमेंट इज कंप्लीट व्हेन अफगानिस्तान फेल to Taliban, and I give about 10 years for sea encirclement if we do not wake up today. Today we are going to take countries to find out how exactly our geopolitical decisions in the last 75 years have affected us or what they have manifested into. A major portion of this particular episode is going to be conducted by Professor Sonali Chidarkar from Miranda House, Delhi University. You are well aware of her. Over to her for conducting this particular episode. Yeah, Sonali.
Okay, so thank you, Colonel Pandey. And today we are speaking about three very crucial areas in our neighborhood. We are going to be talking about Sri Lanka. We are going to be talking about Myanmar and we are going to be talking about Nepal. And very crucial historical junctures in our relationship with all three areas. So when we talk about Sri Lanka, we will talk about the intervention of the IPKF in Sri Lanka. We will also look at how with Myanmar, because of its proximity to China, how Myanmar is an important area for us. And how we have not, or maybe we need to do a little more in trying to stabilize that region. And of course, Nepal is historically has been a part of our cultural landscape, and political boundaries have changed. And so with Nepal, more or less, I feel it's a family relationship that at times the graph goes up, the graph goes down. So coming to Sri Lanka, which is a very, may seem to be a small, you know, a little island country connected to us just by the Ram Setu. However, again, even with Sri Lanka, there is a people connection there, which we cannot deny, which we have to append that connect, which is the connect that we have with the population living in Tamil Nadu and the similarities with the population of Sri Lanka, the Tamil population in Sri Lanka. So I do not understand how we could have, you know, overlooked that connect, and somehow as a nation, the entire episode of the IPKF seemed like creating a huge rupture between people, and it seemed like turning on your military onto your own people in a sense. Of course, there was a angle of international relations there, where we were seen as helping out a country with a sovereign country with, you know, its internal problems and whatever. Hindsight is not a very good position to stand at and look at these crucial connects. But the thing that we need to remember is that the IPKF action is something that will not be forgotten by a huge population, both in Tamil Nadu and in Sri Lanka. So I can't, every time I talk about Sri Lanka or teach about this area, I recall this young student of mine who was in class, and he was a Sri Lankan Tamilian. And every time we spoke about this, we tried to give them a balance, what is called a balanced outlook, you know, balancing all perspectives. But I clearly remember his face, a thin, wiry, small boy, but his eyes used to blooden up. They used to go red when we were speaking about this. Such was the emotion that was attached to, you know. So what we have now done effectively with Sri Lanka is our relationship with the country should have been very different from what it is now. We have practically delivered Sri Lanka into China's lap. And let's also remember that in today's world, economics will take precedence over any historical or people-to-people connect. So the kind of depth that China has managed to achieve in Sri Lanka is something that we should think about. And we have a much longer, a much deeper connect with Sri Lanka, which the people to people connect, which can be really, you know, which should be used, which should be utilized for our mutual advantage. It's a relationship that is likely to be mutually beneficial. India has to focus on that. Myanmar is a very crucial area for the stability of Northeast India, and especially areas like Manipur, etc., where it becomes very easy for China to again play the northeastern area up through Myanmar. So having said that, yes, Myanmar has a history of military governments, and how a democracy like India should respond to a military government like Myanmar. However, we have also seen over the past few years how we have supported democracy. We have looked at, we have a huge influx of Burmese refugees in India, whom India has, given space to settle and grow. However, we still are not able to understand, we are able to understand, but there are certain things even in international relations and geopolitics which we are not able to resolve. Obviously, because the Burmese government is closer to ideologically and, in terms of functioning, much closer to China than India has always been a democracy, maybe a flawed or a growing democracy, but nevertheless, it has been a democracy. So how do we look at Myanmar? How do we look at, making our, establishing our interests in that area is another thing which we have to think about. Like we always have said in our episodes, we need to think ahead into the future, 25 years thence. With Nepal, the relationship, again, the political alignment between the communist government in Nepal and the CCP in China is something that has not really played up to our advantage, despite the fact that culturally Nepal and India share a bond which is, I believe it's in continuity. It's not something that has ever been ruptured by any change of political systems. So it's not something that worries us. It's not something that should worry us if, periodically we see the media and, associated groups play up this thing between Nepal and India. But I believe it's something like a friendly, fight within the family. Having said that, Nepal is also something, is also an area that we must secure for our own national interests. So, over to you now for the military aspects of these areas that we have just discussed.
Thank you, Sonali. That was brilliant, giving a brief on all the three countries and the way you perceive it, the way you see it. There are a couple of words which Sonali said, which I have picked up, and I want to start with them. She said, in hindsight, we cannot, and whatever justifications for the actions we are talking of. This series is all about hindsight. The series is all about hindsight. We are taking stock of 75 years. We are talking in terms of geopolitical intelligence, geopolitical knowledge, geopolitical awareness, and geopolitical responsibility, as is being exercised by students to everyone in bureaucracy, to the political class, to executive, military. Is everyone doing it correctly? Is that knowledge there for everyone to do it correctly? Whatever decisions we have taken in past, is geopolitics responsible somewhere? In the sense that lack of knowledge resulted in that. When you talk about Sri Lanka, will I be wrong to say, Professor Sonali, that the center played its own geopolitics and Tamil Nadu government played its own geopolitics? Were there not two different geopolitics being played? Mm-hmm. Is Tamil Nadu not as much part of India?
Yeah.
where we should have actually been firstly in alignment with Tamil Nadu, and together we should have been in alignment with Sri Lanka, respecting the religious and the cultural mix of that country. In hindsight, it is very easily said, but then who died? Secondly, are we trying to say that military did not have its compulsions when it came to IPKF? Is military so much neutral that the Tamilians in military would not have been affected?
Yeah, it's a very valid point actually.
So, and each one of us know how exactly is the military composed.
Yeah.
So overall, had the knowledge of geopolitics been at that level where the awareness was so high, so whether it was a policy maker or whether it was even a politician, would you have done this? When Professor Sonali says that we actually have given Sri Lanka in the lap of China, I think we delivered it ourselves. Whether the port is there, and I always say, if you want to understand the geopolitics of India with reference to water and land, just reverse the map, inverse the map. Let Sri Lanka be on top and just see what is there in front of you. You have such massive ocean, Indian Ocean. And on one side you have Arabian Sea, on the other side you have Bay of Bengal. And you see the expanse from Australia to South Africa. Could you afford to have a country, an island country, next to your coast? It is so close that half the time our fishermen are all arrested by them. So close, handed over to China, who we did not have courage to declare as our enemy. And all this happens because in our previous episodes, when we have spoken of that geopolitics is all about identifying your friends, identifying your enemies, identifying your allies, and thereafter you are actually analyzing the entire way, how are you going to handle it. We don't even identify China as an enemy. So this is what happens. Extend that to Myanmar. Myanmar has got a Chinese port now.
Yeah.
Right? Bangladesh has got a Chinese port. True. So Arabian Sea is gone. Mm-hmm. When you say Myanmar, your entire Southeast Asia, the sea lanes to that. You talk about Sri Lanka, practically your entire eastern seaboard is with them. Come on the western seaboard, you talk about Gwadar. When you are talking about Gwadar, just see what is happening with the Arabian Sea. So are we now waiting for them to come to Indian Ocean? Where are we going wrong exactly? Did we not have someone tell the people who took decisions that time that in the long run, these things are going to cost us very heavily? IPKF is 89-90.
Yeah, yes.
89-90 is the time when we had gone aggressively ahead in Arunachal.
Yeah.
So this means it is not that we did not identify. Mm. There was a time when George Fernandez said something about China being enemy.
He said, China is enemy number one.
Exactly. General Sundarji.
Yeah.
So the thing is that when there are people who actually had this sort of a vision, they said it. All we did in turn was to just overlook whatever they said.
True.
Where are we exactly? Today, is there any bureaucrat or politician who took the decisions in 90s about not identifying China as enemy? Is he there to answer us, this generation today, as to why is this state there in Indian Ocean, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka? When we talk about Myanmar, we are talking about 1945 when the Stillwell Road was built from Tinsukia to China, not Myanmar. That road was made for China. Japanese had occupied entire Myanmar.
True.
The British army, the British Indian army, we were here actually to wrest back Myanmar from Japan.
True. Yeah.
So now if that sort of history and that sort of connect with religion and the ethnic flow right from our eastern states that goes into Southeast Asia and the ethnic connect of the people. Did we exploit it? Did we exploit the ethnic connect of Tamil Nadu not only to Sri Lanka? You see the entire southeastern Asian countries, Indonesia, Malaysia, the number of Tamilians you find there, sixth generation, seventh generation Tamilians.
True.
I have met them and they have all their connect back in Tamil Nadu. So this entire thing was part of our history.
True.
So we've just thrown it away. And why? Because we have not given importance to the geopolitics as a subject in which the entire country needs to come up. Education right from your school. We cannot have maps in the school which are much, much removed from reality. Coming to Nepal again. So Nepal, whenever it comes to Nepal, I always talk about the entire lay of the Himalayan range. Taking a average peak height of say 15,000 plus, join all the points right from the Pamir Knot, come down to Arunachal and just join all these points. What you will see, Nepal is either on the edge or south of it, which means it was not only removed from China by Himalayas in a massive way, there also was massive Tibet in between, which actually is a separate landmass from China. And here it is a Hindu kingdom, a declared Hindu kingdom, where right from mythology, the stories of Ramayana go from there right up to Sri Lanka. So how is it that UP does not become
the
link of people to people connect? East, people to people connect. Tamil Nadu, people to people connect. This is the place probably we have gone completely wrong in our decision making when we see look at the last 75 years. So today when I talk to you, when Sonali is talking to you, the point is not about the last 75 years. Our point is, are we planning something properly for the next 25?
Yeah.
Are we prepared for the next 25? Is there a plan for next 25? With no geopolitical knowledge being imparted formally to the military people, the armed forces, it is not part of our culture. The armed forces suddenly start learning geopolitics after they put in 2 stars or 3 stars. And the intelligence shows very prominently in media, whether positively or negatively, I will not comment. You all read and hear as much as I do. So you're free to make your judgment. I am personally saddened. When we talk about East, this would be the summing up I am doing. When we talk about the East, look East policy, you can't look East from Delhi.
True.
When you look East, you have to look East from Assam or those 7 states.
True.
You cannot look at Southeast Asia from Delhi. You have to look at it from Tamil Nadu.
True.
When you're talking about Himalayan Command and everything and those theaters, it cannot be looked from one corner of Eastern Command that sits comfortably in Calcutta. What business Eastern Command has got sitting in Calcutta? Shouldn't Eastern Command actually be in East? And there is a Northern Command too much in the North? Then who exactly is looking after Himalayas? Would Nepal not have been part of this geopolitical culture, mindset and the plans had we got our geopolitics correct? So overall, when we talk about the geopolitics, when we talk about placing our resources, our thought and intent has to match with the actions we are taking on ground. So it cannot be all talk.
True.
So this is how actually we have looked at Sri Lanka, Myanmar and Nepal in last so many years, 75 years. And I think there has to be a major, major shift in the military mindset, which as it is known to be extremely rigid.
True.
Very rigid in thinking that this culture starts now, it takes 10 years to get affected, the first level to get affected. And by the time the generals come up, it will be 30 years.
True.
So unless you have a 25-year plan now and a 50-year plan now and also involve everyone, I think we again are going to have the same episodes Someone else will be doing it 75 years hence, and they'll be covering the last 150 years. Over to you, Sonali.
So yeah, very rightly said. So with our neighbors, somehow we have to really think about how to position ourselves, how to understand that. Yeah, having to play geopolitics in a way that is beneficial to national interest would require a lot of investment, both from the, like we have already said, from the academic establishment, from the military establishment, and from the political establishment. And also, we need to understand that somehow we have developed a reputation of being a mini USA in this region. Definitely, our perspective goes down to having a people-to-people connect and in no way being a regional hegemon or, you know, being a threat, being perceived as a big brother in the neighborhood is definitely not something that should underlie our either our geopolitical strategies and understanding or our neighborhood policies in the future. With that, I think we have more or less covered the area and the points that we needed to talk about. I think we can...
Yeah, with this we come to the end of the episode 4. From here, we go to episode 5, which is going to be very interesting, where a new term is being discussed, mm-hmm. which Professor Sonali, being a formal teacher, a professor may not agree. Mm-hmm. But somehow I feel it is there, that is reverse geopolitics. Mm-hmm. See you then in the 5th episode. Thank you so much for being with us. Me and Professor Sonali say bye to you. Bye-bye. Bye.